Well, good morning, South Street Church. It's great to be with you again on a Sunday morning. I hope you're all there in your homes, feeling connected, even though we are scattered as a church. I'm going to read to you the last couple of verses from Psalm 27 to begin with. And then I'm going to just bring you a few little notices. Then we'll pray, and then I'll hand over to, I think it's Baz and Ben for a little skit or a kids thing. Claire is going to lead us in some musical worship. Paul Jennings is going to bring us a message from Hebrews today. And then Claire is going to bring us a little bit more musical worship, and John Price will close for us in prayer. So that's what you have to look forward to today. Let me open with these words from Psalm 27. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. Let me open in prayer. Father God, thank you that you are sovereign, that you have everything in your hands, that you will bring about all things for the good of those that love you and who are called according to your purposes. Father, we do pray that you would keep our eyes fixed on you, that we would continue in you, that we would immerse ourselves in you, in your word, in prayer, and that you would speak to us, that you would draw close to us in this time, that we would hear from you, that we would be able to encourage each other as you encourage us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you may have seen the little update on Thursday of this week, so I'm just going to remind you of a couple of those things that we talked about then. First of all, home groups. Well done if you've managed to get Zoom up and running, or any of the other video conferencing options that enable whole groups to be able to talk at the same time. From remote locations. If you need any help with that, please get in touch with us. If you would like to join a home group, it's still very possible to do that. There are people still joining home groups. People have joined home groups in the last 2 weeks via Zoom and have been really blessed by that. So if you'd like to join a home group, I'd thoroughly encourage you to do that. Home group material, as you are aware, we've just finished our Bible in a Year series. So we started just before Easter last year, and here we are, we've just come into land just before Easter of this year. So well done if you have persevered through the Bible in a year, and if this is the first time you've ever read the Bible from cover to cover in one go, well done. If you've nearly done that, and there are just a few gaps in your readings, what a great opportunity right now to refocus on those, to fill in the gaps. Can I encourage you to do that? Really, really valuable and fruitful thing to do. So, yeah, and perhaps off the back of that, I know that Simon Ogden reads through the Bible every year in a different version. So if you've just finished reading NIV with the dulcet tones of David Suchet, perhaps you want to consider reading a different version over this next year, or maybe over 2 years. There are different Bible reading plans that you can use. If you want any advice with any of that, then just get in touch. Going forward from here, this coming week, we are going to use some materials that are from the Bible Project once again. And we're going to take a topic-based approach. The first topic that we'll be looking at this week coming in our home groups is generosity. and there'll be a bunch of resources that will be available for you to study yourselves at home during the week. There's podcasts that you can listen to, and there'll be questions that you can prepare for in your Bible study groups on Zoom during the week. So I hope that's a real blessing to you. There's always the customary little videos that Bible Project do that they're so good at. So yeah, I hope that's a real blessing to you. Good. I'm going to hand over to Baz for our kids slot.
A very long time ago, right here in this world, there was a garden. In the garden, everything was wonderful. The world was full of laughing and playing and smiling and fun. There was nothing bad ever. There was nothing, no one sad ever. And best of all, God was there. Hello, Adam. Hello, Eve. He loved it all. People could see God and speak to God and just enjoy being with God. The people did a terrible thing. They didn't want to do what God said. They decided they wanted a world without God in charge. God cause this sin. Sin spoils things, so sin has no place in God's wonderful garden. God said to the people, "You can't live with me in my garden anymore." And he sent them outside to show the people they had to stay outside. God put some warrior angels in front of the garden. The angels were like a big keep out sign. Now things were sometimes bad and people were sometimes sad, but people still kept singing because they didn't want God to be in charge, so no one could come into God's wonderful place.
God wanted people to remember it is wonderful to live with him, but because of your sins you can't come in. So he told the people to build a special building called his temple where he would live. In the middle of the temple was the most wonderful place in the world. The palace where gods did nothing bad and nothing sad. It was very accurate.
But then God told people to put a big curtain around this wonderful, wonderful place. The curtain and had pictures of
warrior angels
on it. It was a big keep outside. For hundreds of years, the temple curtain reminded people that God said it is wonderful to live with him, but because of your sin, you can't come in.
Babies become big grown-ups and have babies, and those babies become grown-ups and have babies, and those babies become grown-ups and they have babies. Hundreds of summers and winters pass by, and the keep-out curtain stays in the temple.
God the Son came to live in this world as a person. He was called Jesus. Jesus always did what God said. Jesus never sinned. And Jesus visited the temple where the keep out curtain hung. Jesus knew that things were sometimes bad and sometimes sad. Jesus said that God had sent him to open the way back to God's wonderful place, where there would be nothing bad and no one sad, but ... Oh, people still didn't want to let God be in charge, so they decided to put Jesus on a cross to die. It was the most bad, the most sad day of all times. But Jesus had a plan. He had always planned to die on the cross. What a strange plan. On the cross, Jesus took our sin, all the bad things we do, and all the sad things they cause. The curtain tore and God ripped up the keep out sign. God's wonderful place is open again. Because Jesus died, he can go in. Jesus died. His friends put him in a tomb. They were very sad. For 2 days, nothing happened. When the next morning, Jesus's friends went to see his body in the tomb, and it wasn't there.
A little later on, Jesus's friends were all together, and suddenly Jesus was there, alive. Suddenly his friends weren't sad now. They were so, so happy God had brought Jesus back to life so that he could live in God's wonderful place forever. Jesus has sent everyone an invitation to come in and come and live with. Because of your sin, you can't come in, but I died on the cross to take your sin, so all my friends can now come in. No one said, come on in, friends. We will see God and speak to God and just enjoy being with God just as he planned. It will be wonderful to live with him. And it's all because of Jesus. All because of Jesus. We will say every day, thank you.
We hope you've enjoyed the garden, the curtain, and the cross. An isolation production.
Yeah, that was so good. Well done, girls. Well done, Baz and Ben and Dan. That's amazing. Thank you also, Dan, so much for putting together all of the service and editing it all for us. He's been spending hours doing it all, so we're really, really grateful. Thank you, Dan and Ben, for doing all of that stuff. So thank you. Why don't we all stand together, even though we're apart, let's stand together in our living rooms as a church and sing together to our awesome God. Over to you, Claire.
We're going to start with a song that you can do the actions to at home, My Lighthouse.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, troubled sea.
Thank you.
We have a good and a faithful God, don't we? A good and a faithful God. Thank you, Claire, for leading us. And let me pray for Paul before he brings the word to us from Hebrews, a message of encouragement and perseverance. Father God, thank you for your people, Lord. Thank you for all those who have brought something to share with us as part of this service. Thank you for Baz and Ben and Dan and the girls, and thank you for Claire and her gifts and abilities. Lord, we thank you for Paul and for the time and energy that he's put into preparing a message for us. We pray that you would speak to us through his words. Thank you that you can work through all situations. Thank you that you are a good, good God, and that you are a faithful God. And we want to be a people who persevere through the hard times and bring glory to your name. Amen.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us.
Well, hello and good morning. Can I welcome you to this part of our virtual Sunday service? Today the sermon is going to be through a slide presentation with my voice in the background, which I'm sure you're only too pleased that you won't have to look at me the whole time, but just at the slides that I've prepared. We have finished going through the Bible in 1 year, and I trust that you have found that a profitable exercise. But today we're going to look at a passage in Hebrews, which I think will be of encouragement to us all. And that passage is on perseverance, both perseverance and the encouragement to each other to persevere. Our reading is from Hebrews chapter 10 and starting at verse 19. Now, Hebrews is interesting in that none of the Bible scholars really know who wrote it. Some say Paul, some say Barnabas, or Apollos, or Silas, Aquila, or Philip. If you have the King James Version, you'll find that it's attributed to Paul, but I think modern scholars are less and less certain that that's the case. The reason why they think that that's not the case is that it's so much unlike the letters that are definitely his. Personally, I've always thought that it's not a letter at all, but a sermon. It's quite a lengthy one, but it has none of the attributes of a letter and all of the attributes of a sermon. It has a clear start and finish, it uses a logical progression of thought, and it uses far more references to scripture per page than any of the letters in the Bible. So here it is, here's our passage. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Well, our passage starts with the word therefore. And therefore, it's a linking adverb. So it's clear that the passage that we have just read is linked to the passage before it. And it's important. So let's have a quick look at what has preceded our reading. Well, really, you have to go right the way back to the beginning of Hebrews. You have to get that the writer, you have to understand that the writer is taking the whole of the message of the Old Testament and is putting it before his Hebrew, his Jewish audience, and is describing to them how what has happened in the past, as recorded in the Old Testament, is now being fulfilled in the New. So the themes of the book of Hebrews are the following. Angels that appeared in history had a message from God, but they were not as important as Christ Jesus. Moses was a faithful servant and part of God's plan, but was not as faithful as Christ Jesus. The high priests were mediators with God, but were not immortal mediators like Christ Jesus. The old covenant that God had given to the Jews was of value, but was not as important as the covenant that we have through Christ Jesus. So that's the message of Hebrews. God gave Jesus as his final word. He is the living and only way. When we come to the chapter 10, which is what we have read from, we learn the following truths that the Bible tells us again and again. Firstly, it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. They were merely a picture of what was going to come in the future to take away our sins. We have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. And for by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. So the Bible teaches us that our sins and lawless acts will be remembered no more, and we have a new and living way to come before God through Christ Jesus. They're glorious truths. We are told to have them engraved in our hearts. So by all means, underline them in your Bible, write them on your walls, carry them as notes in your bag or wallet. But let's come back to our passage again. And I don't know if you noticed that there is a phrase that recurs. Here it is, highlighted. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess. Let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. And let us not give up meeting together, but let us encourage one another. So they're all lettuces, aren't they? So forgive me. There we are. We have five lettuces, three large and two small. Let's move on to the first lettuce. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. So here we now start applying to our everyday lives the doctrines that we have been told earlier in this book. All right, do you remember I was saying how the writer has pointed out everything that has happened through the Old Testament and is saying now those things are now being fulfilled. And so this is the practical implication of that doctrine that has been laid down. We have the symbolism of the Old Testament. The high priest entered the sanctuary of the temple after and through the sacrifice of bulls and goats. He sprinkled blood as a symbol of the ratification of the covenant between God and man. We enter the sanctuary of God after and through the sacrifice of Christ Jesus, with our hearts sprinkled by the water of baptism as a ratification of the new covenant that we have in Christ's sacrifice. You see, Old Testament, Old Covenant, moving on to the new covenant that we have through Christ. Now, I was always taught that when considering any action, to look at the whys and the hows. So let's have a look at the why. Why should we draw near to God? Well, because we should have confidence, verse 19. As God himself has spoken to us through his word, the Bible, with confidence. Why should we draw near? Because our sins and lawless acts will be remembered no more. Verse 17. We are forgiven only because of the sacrifice of Christ. But that's the reason why we should draw near. But also there's the fearful expectation of judgment that will otherwise be ours. The Bible reminds us that Christ Jesus will be our judge as well as our friend. We should draw near to him because the alternative is being an enemy of God and receiving the judgment of God. The Bible is not just about God's gift. It's also about God's judgment. Accept one or receive the other. How do we draw near to God? Well, we have a great high priest. He's our intermediary. The acts of a priest were to perform continual sacrifices. Jesus was once and for all. The Son of God died for you and for me. So we draw near to God on our knees, don't we? Not necessarily physically, particularly if you are in the habit of praying in your car, but we pray. In these times where we're trying to fill time as we are being isolated at home, well, fill some of it with extra prayer. How do we draw near to God? Well, through the sacrifice of Jesus, once and for all. The new covenant is only through the sacrifice that Christ undertook in the Garden of Gethsemane. Contemporary philosophy centres on mankind and our experience. The Bible centres on Christ and his gift. So take some time to contemplate who God is and what Christ has done before you bring your list of requests in prayer. How do we draw near to God? Third one, having our hearts cleansed from a guilty conscience. Some time ago, I read an article in a highly reputable paper that talked about how most of us suffer from memories of our mistakes and how we beat ourselves up sometimes when we remember stupid things and sins that we have done. And it was pointing out that others who do awful things seem to live happy lives since they're not racked by guilt. And the article was asking, how do we achieve the same? How do we stop beating ourselves up? And the answer of this article was hypnosis. But the Bible gives a different answer. The Bible's answer is the grace of God through believing in his atoning sacrifice of his Son. Forgiveness for what we have done. Forgiveness is available to all of us right now. So it's very important to make sure that we are right with God. Let's move on to the second lettuce. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Why should we hold to the hope that we have? For he who promised is faithful. The Bible has many promises from Christ. Do you remember many or any of them? Perhaps you remember, I am the way, the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Or perhaps you remember, I have prepared a place for you. Or perhaps you remember, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Well, here's a challenge for you. Allocate some of this amazing free time that you have at the moment to remember some of his promises. Put them in your heart. As I say, write them, underline them in your Bible, if that's what you wish to do. Why should we hold to the hope we have? Because you will receive the reward that he has promised. We have the reward of heavenly, of eternal life with Christ in heaven. And why should we hold? Because by believing we will be saved. By grace you have been saved through faith, and that's not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. How do we hold to the hope that we have? Well, by reading God's word. In Hebrews, I have counted 30 quotes from the Old Testament and innumerable references to the Bible as they had it when this book was written. Here's my another challenge. Can you think of 30 quotes from the Bible? There's a challenge for you. Is my further challenge is memorize a verse a day all the time that we are housebound. Difficult for us more senior ones, but you youngsters may well be able to do that. Get the Bible imprinted in your hearts. It will be of real use to you in future years. How do we hold on to the hope? Well, by not deliberately sinning. If you have an unhelpful habit, then now is the time to bring it to prayer and possibly seek the help that you might need. How do we hold to the hope? Well, by accepting insults and remaining firm in our faith, not denying God as Peter did, but holding, putting forth Christ on the occasional chats that you will have, even now and in the future. But our third lettuce. Let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds. Spur one another on. Stop looking to others for people to spur you on. Go and spur them on. Encouragement is one of the great Christian gifts listed in Romans 12. Encourage each other. Spur people on. Spur them on what to? Spur them on to love. Here is one of the proofs that you are a Christian. By this they shall know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. So show love. Be kind. Be gentle. Be generous, even under the tensions that you may be under at the moment. And good deeds. Spur people onto good deeds. Forget the slurs about do-gooders. Try and be a do-gooder. Try to do so every day. You may not be able to do so whilst you're trapped at home, but you can do so with the family that you're trapped with. You may be able to do so as a volunteer. The phone and social media might provide a resource for such actions. And when Boris finally releases you, you will then be well practiced. So now is the time to test yourself. So there are our three lettuces of encouragement. However, there are two more lettuces which the editor of the second edition of the NIV has rather messed up by translating them slightly differently. So sorry if you have the second edition of the NIV, you'll have to look for them in vain. But if you have the first edition, they're there. The first little lettuce is, let us not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. Now, of course, this at the present time is ever so slightly ironic. But when we are finally released, keep coming to church services. Keep meeting together. Meet together for prayer. Get out to church when you can. Meet in house groups. Invite people to come and have Bible readings with you. When you're able, show hospitality. Meet together. Don't give up meeting together. And at this time, when we are self-isolated or social distancing, use the internet, of course, as you're doing at the moment. Use Skype, use Zoom, use Microsoft Messenger, and not forgetting the humble telephone. Keep communicating. Keep encouraging. As John Wesley said, there's nothing more unchristian than a solitary Christian. Let's move on to the second little lettuce. Let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Encourage each other just by that phone call. When we can leave the house, you can meet your fellow Christians. Encourage others by reading and praying together. Currently, you might be able to do that remotely, but soon you'll be able to do it face to face. There's a real encouragement in talking about Christ. There's an encouragement in recalling what he has done for you. I know at least one of you wakes up each morning and recounts God's blessings before they progress on to the rest of the day. Good exercise to do. Remember that the day of Christ's return is coming. Some of us might well die before it happens, but all that will mean is that we meet him before everyone else. We still have to attend that meeting, and it will be a glorious celebration for those who love Christ. So as we approach Easter, when we particularly remember the sacrifice of Christ Jesus, be encouraged. Encourage others. Stay safe. Every blessing to you all. Amen. Amen.
Oh, amen. Thank you, Paul. That was really, really encouraging. Thank you. And why don't we stand together again and let's sing together. Let's pray as we sing that the eyes of our hearts would be open, that we would know the goodness and the faithfulness of God. Let's stand together and sing. Thank you. Jesus Christ, for his death and his resurrection. Thank you that he has paid our ransom and we are set free, that we can live in freedom. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Well, I'm going to hand over to John and Vix now, who are going to lead us and close our service in a time of prayer together. John and Vix.
We're going to pray. Heavenly Father, help us just to sink into you right now, and just Lord, to sense you. And God, I just ask that you would still our hearts. Lord, we just we acknowledge you as King over all. We acknowledge you as great, as all powerful, as almighty. We know that you have got our entire lives, Lord, in your hands right now. We know, Father God, that you have a way through all of this, that you have a way through for each one of us, that in fact every promise that you have laid on our lives, Lord, in the past and through scripture are not null and void now because of what's happening, but they are still being fulfilled, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that there is still, Lord, that you still have a hope and a future laid out for us, that you know what you want us to be doing. You know where you want us to be, God. But right now, Lord Jesus, in this really strange patch of life, I just pray that each one of us, Lord God, would be recalibrated. That this would become an opportunity for us just to sit back and open our lives up for you to have your way within us. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would strip out, Lord God, of our busy lives the things that really are cluttering us up and the things that are stealing our priorities and stealing our time. And Lord Jesus, instead, might we just turn to refocus upon you. I pray, Lord, that just over this coming week, you would bless each of the church members, each one of us, Lord God. May we come out of this coming week, Lord God, different to the way that we entered it. May we come out of it closer to you, with hearts really fixed upon you. And Lord Jesus, we just say, have your way. Just change me. Change me, make me more like you. Make me more effective for you, dear God. May my worship to you, Lord, be just true. Amen.
Amen. And yeah, just listening to a song beforehand, the words that really came out was, set the captives free. And I just do claim that for each of us, although we might feel captive and trapped into our small bubbles, I pray that you just release us, break us free into relationship with you, where although we are contained, we're just overflowing with joy and peace and security in you, our Lord, our Saviour. And I just claim that intimacy that is there to be had in relationship with you, whether we're on our own or in a family or with friends in our space, that you just build up that that relationship, that although we are contained, we feel free and alive and just being able to run a full pelt with you. So I pray for real blessing this week in our Bible studies and in our prayer time and in our worship around the house, that you would be ever present, you'd be ever speaking to us and really guiding us in this time of rest as well. So thank you, Lord, that you've got us, you know what's going on, and we rest in you. And we just pray that your will be done. Thank you, Lord.